Hi all,
Will here.
Let's build a MemGPT Discord agent together in LangGraph. For those of you who haven't read it yet, MemGPT is a great paper by Packer et al. Out of this lab in Berkeley. They show that you can prompt an LLM to manage its own memory using function calling and tools. The agent we are going to build today is inspired by MemGPT. It will have both core memories and recall, so semantic memories, and will deploy it on LangGraph Cloud. Finally, we're going to deploy a Discord server so that we can interact with it in Discord and it can continue to learn our preferences and personalities. The agent that we'll create will have a pretty simple workflow. For each message, it'll enter here, we'll load memories for that particular user based on ID. The agent will then decide whether to use any tools in order to respond or in order to just save your memories. Finally, it'll generate the response message, which will then be sent back to the user. And the load memories is able to fetch the core memories from that user, as well as semantic memories, which are ones that are stored in a vector score. The agent then can query more semantic memories if we feel like the ones that are queried weren't actually that relevant or useful. It can use other tools that we provided, such as a web search tool, to answer the user's question. And it can also store and upsert different types of memories there. Before we get too far along, we have two basic prerequisites. We're going to need a vector store index for our recall memory. We're going to use Pinecone for this example. So we'll go ahead and create an index here. You can do that by logging in and then creating the index. We'll set this as 700 dimensions for the embedding distance, since we're going to be using gnomic embed text, which is similar to the BERT encoder for the dimensionality of the output. You can call it a specific name and then you'll create it. Once you create it, you want to make sure that you copy over the region, you copy over the actual name, and that you have access to the API keys that you created here. Next, we'll create our API keys to connect to the LLM. In this case, we're going to use a Llama 3 fine-tuned model fire function from Fireworks. So with that prerequisites out of the way, let's go and fork the repo. We'll take that and then we'll clone it locally. And then once we've cloned it, we can pull it up here. Here we have our repo structure. If you're not familiar with LangGraph Cloud yet, a typical LangGraph Cloud structure contains a configuration file, which defines the different types of graphs that we're going to be exposing. In this case, we just have this one memory graph, which is the MemGPT implementation. You can expose the environment variables that you're going to be injecting in it, and you also define dependencies. By putting the local directory here, this will infer the dependencies from my pyproject.toml file, which then is a classic Python way of packaging projects. Within here, you can see we've added a bunch of different LLMs, so you can swap out for OpenAI or Anthropic, all without having to change anything in code. Next, we'll go over this basic agent style. We've got some constants and schemas. These are just tiny things that we'll go through. The most important part that we want to look at is this graph.py file. If you look at the overview for the file, you can see we defined these four different tools that are related to memory management. We have save recall memory and store core memory. These are the two ways that the agent is able to persist memories about the user. We also have search and fetch core memories. Search queries semantically over past save recall memories, and fetch core memories just returns all of the core memories, which is just a list of strings for this particular user. Now we've got the actual graph definition below. We'll go in more detail in a second. We've got the agent node here. This is just the LLM being prompted to be responding or using tools in order to respond and answer the user's question. We've got the load memories function here. And this just takes the user ID from our configuration, so the bot doesn't get to choose what types of data access it has. And it fetches those relevant memories before the LLM even gets to see the input. We have the route tools function, which is routing the messages to the tools node if the AI decides to be calling some of those tools. Otherwise, it'll respond to the user directly. And then finally, we have the tool node here, which we just use with this pre-built decorator. This will invoke any tool that is called by the agent and that is found within that suffix AI message whenever the state enters the tools node. For save recall memory, we'll fetch the embeddings, we'll fetch the vector, or actually generate the vector, and then we'll add some metadata like the current time so that you could be querying and filtering based on that. And then we're storing this all into the vector database. The key thing here is we're looking up based on a single vector on this memory string. You can look up in other ways if you want. Next, we define the search memory function. This is a similar structure. So we're going to get the embeddings, we'll embed the query, and then we'll be looking up based on similar memories. you can see that we're passing in the user ID and our configuration, and this is always going to be configured based on your front end in regular code. And this filters to make sure that it's only able to fetch memories that were saved for this signed in user or for the connecting user. Next, we have the type. So we're only going to be fetching over recall, and then we'll get those responses and return the strings of memory there. We have the fetch core memories, which is similar. We're just going to do a direct get operation on the database there. And then we have the store memories here. This lets us actually save the memory. And if the AI wants to, we can use it to overwrite an existing one. For instance, if I have a memory that I've been chatting about how, oh, I really love Taylor Swift, and then all of a sudden I decide, oh, man, you know what, I'm a little bit tired of it, they can update that. It's maybe not a core memory, but things that it might want to be altering or updating has that ability to do. We'll define all the tools, and these will be made available to the agent there. We have the prompt, which I've added to try to encourage it to use these memory tools as readily as possible for the sake of this demo. I always like to include the system time so it has a little bit more context and doesn't think that it's still 2022 or wherever it was trained until. And we're going to be templating in any memories here if they are fetched. Now going back to the agent, we have this init chat model based on whatever the model that is configured here. The configuration, we default to this Llama 3 Fireworks model. You can change it to Sonnet, or so Claude Sonnet, or OpenAI, or Gemini as well. Next, we'll provide the tool schemas, which just is a way to define an interface between the functions you need to call and the agent. In the end, we're just passing in JSON schemas to the LLM so that it knows the format of the output that's expected to generate. If we have core memories or recall memories that are already populated for this user, we can populate it in here. And then we'll finally generate this prediction using the LLM. This goes into our messages state. For load memories, basically this is the entry point of the graph. We want to make sure that the LLM has all the contextual information it needs before it has to make any decision. So we're going to do this by running in the fetch core memories and the search memory functions here before it even gets the LLM. And then after that, the LLM is allowed to do other types of queries. So now that we've gone over the graph, it's time to deploy it. We'll do so on LangGraph Cloud. So first navigate to Langsmith, click on Deployments, and then press New Deployment. You'll want to add the LangGraph Cloud installer to your account. Once you've logged into GitHub, you can select to share all the repositories, or you can select a select few. I'm going to say LangMemGPT as a repo that I'm going to add, and then hit Save. Once you've done this, it should show up in the list of available repositories you can deploy from. I'm going to call this MemGPT. The configuration file in this repo is at the root directory. If you clone it and move it to a separate directory, you can always add a path to it. You can also pick a different reference, a different branch to deploy from. LangGraph Cloud also allows you to select a different deployment type. We're just going to go with development here. Now, finally, it's time to add the environment variables. The key ones to add are Pinecone and Firework. You can create these in a .env file and then copy paste that format into the UI. You'll also want to create a Tavoli account, which I failed to mention before. And this will provide the search engine access if you want your agent to be able to query the web. Once you're done, hit submit. LangGraph Cloud will start building your Docker image and then eventually deploy. If you run into any issues, check the build logs here to see if there's any errors that show up, or the deploy logs. Common issues include not having the environment variables set correctly or forgetting to add different dependencies into your LangGraph project. All right. So if everything worked correctly, after 3 to 4 minutes, you should have a new deployment already. You can head to the playground in order to try interacting with it directly in the UI. The LangGraph Cloud Studio is a great place to be able to debug and deeply visualize how your graph or agent is operating on different types of inputs. If you recall from the code review, we have a few different configurations we can make for this graph. For instance, you can choose a model, you can choose a thread, and you can also add the user ID here. So for user ID here, we'll say my user 3, and then we can try adding some messages. So for instance, today I had pie. And then you can see here how the agent's going through. So you see it first tried to load memories from me, and then it tries to go in and call the agent. The agent decides this isn't a particularly important message, and then it actually gets sent back. This is a nice UI if you're trying to be developing it, but this isn't something you're going to be exposing to the end user. In phase 2, let's try deploying a Discord server so we can connect to it. If we jump back to a code base, If you remember, we have the basic graph structure here. We have the high-level ones. We also have this advanced server that we have saved in the repository that you cloned. Within this, we have some information and files that are needed in order to be deploying a Discord bot to Cloud Run, actually. So the main file here just defines the Discord bot. It has a couple of events. It has this assistant ID helper, and it has a message handler. So anytime a Discord message comes in, we'll be passing this to our agent that we just deployed on LangGraph, and then immediately respond with the whatever it's going to be responding in Discord. And this just allows it to be forwarding these types of things through WebSocket, like what Discord expects. To deploy to Google Cloud Run, you'll have to create an account here. You'll have to install the Google Cloud SDK. And we're also using the gcloud command line, so you'll want to install that. You'll have to create a Discord developer account, and you have to make sure Docker is installed as well. Then next, you need to set up a Discord bot. You can do that by navigating to this developer portal here, log in, and then we can create a Discord bot. So we'll call this My Memory Bot. Once you have this, we'll go into the bot section and we'll reset the token in order to get our bot token. And then you can get this token here to copy over. You can save this in a .env file here that we're going to be putting in this event server. So we've got the Discord token, the public key actually isn't important, and the assistant URL we can populate from the deployment that we just made over in. You have this deployment, it's this API URL here, so you can copy that over. Once you've copied your token locally, you can customize your bot however you want. You can give it a new username, you can change the banner, you can add icons and stuff. Then you're going to want to navigate to the bot section, and you need to give it message content intent. Otherwise, it won't be able to read any messages. So turn that on and hit save changes to make sure we commit those changes. Next up, we're gonna go to installation because we do wanna install the bot. Eventually, we're gonna be installing it with this link, but first we need to make sure that for the guild install here, we add this bot option. So I'll do that again. You can just type in bot and make sure that you save those changes again. Finally, you're gonna copy this link and go over to it in order to install it to your server, mounting it to the cool memorable server here and authorize. Assuming that you installed your bot correctly with the correct permissions, including the bot permissions, you should see it show up as an ability to at mention the bot, and you can say hello. Hi there, how are you? The Discord server itself creates a new thread and then sends a message to the agent. The agent will then respond with whatever information it has. Great to see you here. We'll do the hello world of LangChain and see if it can check the weather like in SF. Great, so it has the date correct and it also has information there. And then I can say, oh, I'm planning a 4th of July trip to Sacramento. Got any advice? And you see it continues the conversation based on the Discord thread. This is all happening because we're aligning the Discord threads with the threads that we actually track in LangGraph, so it has the full conversation history that's short-term. The bot's also able to actually store some of this long-term information so that it has information across threads. We'll see that in a moment here. We'll see if it can remember it in a new thread here. Hi there. I'm doing some planning. I'm taking a trip to Sacramento. Guess when? It's for the 4th. So it's generating some recommendations here, and we'll see if it's able to actually remember this type of information in the next thread. We'll start a new conversation thread and share some information. I'll say, I like swimming. And then we'll start another one and see if it can remember from that. So it looks like it does remember that I'd mentioned swimming. This is all because I said I like swimming, and this seems like it's pretty salient thing to remember about my core memories. It also is remembering that I'm planning a trip for Sacramento in 4th of July, 2024, because we're timestamping everything and it's including that information here. So cool, it's able to actually do this. Now that we've got this running on a debug server, let's actually deploy it. We'll go through this step by step. We've already cloned it, we've set it up, we've debugged it. Now it's time to set up the Google project. You can create a new one in Google Cloud, or you can use an existing one. In my case, I'm gonna use an existing one here. So I'll say, product ID is this, then I'll enable the necessary APIs, and this is successful. After that, I need to set up permissions for the cloud build services. This creates an IAM policy that'll be able to build the Docker image and then deploy the Cloud Run instance. I'm gonna say no conditions here to really create it, and then it'll create it there. Once that's done, I'll run this script for the deploy server, and it should be up and running. Once you have it up and running, you'll have a Cloud Run instance. You can check the logs to make sure that it's all running correctly. You'll have configuration here with the environment variables that are needed back into your LangGraph instance, and you'll have everything set up for your Discord bot to be communicating with anyone on Discord and relearning about all of the different users. For section 3 of this video, I wanted to briefly touch on evaluating or testing this type of agent. Testing can be hard, and getting it right can be a little bit overwhelming at times. I'm a fan of being pragmatic, adding tests where necessary, adding them as quickly as possible. Even if it's simplistic assertions that catch the base fundamentals, it's better than nothing. And using a tool like LangSmith can help you at least debug and find the root cause of what goes wrong whenever one of these tests do fail in CI. I made an example test file here called test memories that we can use to just go through a couple different conversations and see what actually gets stored. I'm using the LangSmith test decorator here, which syncs this to a data set in LangSmith so that you can be comparing different versions of your system over time. It iterates over the examples. It has some existing memories, for instance, to see how that influences the types of responses that are saved. And then it has the number of expected memories, at least, that will be extracted from this. You have to be mocking different things, perhaps, because you don't want to be touching your actual production database whenever you're running evals, just like any software test. And then you can be doing straight-up relatively simple assertions here if you want. Similarly here, we're testing for the different types of recall memories that are going to be saved there as well. I'll go ahead and run this. I'm also going to be using the test cache here, which will be caching some of the requests, the API requests locally to be a little bit faster in future iterations. And it'll just be running this just with regular PyTest. If I go to the data sets here, I'll see that I'm evaluating these test memories. And you can see I ran this a few times before. I had some bugs that I fixed that caused it to fail the tests. And then you can see outputs here of what was upserted and those types of things. If anything were to go wrong, you can then click in and debug the entire trace of operations. You can see the LLM test. Open it in the playground, debug things. You have that full auditability here while also being able to have very pragmatic metrics and checks running in CI just as you're familiar with any software. So that's all for today. In this video, we created a MemGPT-like agent in LangGraph Cloud, deployed it, deployed a Discord server, and showed how we were able to interact with it in Discord or using the Studio UI to be able to see the exact types of things that are going to be saved and see how that then translates to memory over multiple conversations. If you have any requests or other feedback, leave it in the YouTube comments below. I'd encourage you to go and fork the original repo here and try and build it yourself. And don't forget to check in later for more content like this. Thank you and goodbye.